Hi, we are the group representing Crisis Electronics. I'm Michael.
I'm Fletcher.
I'm Max.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Carlos.
Pretty much our project scope was to analyze Point Judith, and we wanted to determine whether or not it was feasible for the expansion of the New Bedford store into Point Judith. We pretty much wanted to make a list of pros and cons, find out any programs that are available in there that might help with funding, solve problems that are currently going on. We addressed some of them and some of them that will be for next steps. We pretty much based our findings off of a non-financial aspect, like taking into consideration factors like the amount of boats and ferries, all that sort of commercial boats and all that stuff that you'll have access to in Point Judith. We sort of infer that the mission of the company is for Chris Electronics to provide quality marine electronic services, and through that we've determined that Chris Electronics is looking for a customer basis that's loyal, and they're going to find that in Point Judith from what we've found.
So we did a SWOT analysis for Chris Electronics, and some of the strengths we came up with was the knowledge he already has, the quality of the business he does, his experience in the business, and the familiarity with the industry. Some of the weaknesses that we found was when we went to his warehouse, he had a great inventory. Everything was labeled perfectly, everything like that. But one thing he told us he had trouble with was things going in and out of the business. So that was something we wanted to look into for him, a different way of tracking inventory. Some opportunities that we found, there's a new wind power source coming into New Bedford and Rhode Island as well. So we figured it would be more boat traffic, new boats that he needs to maybe fix, things like that. Also, an opportunity of the expansion into Point Judith, which will give him more revenue, more clients once he expands. A threat we found is it's tough to find help because it's a very hard industry to get into. It's not for everybody.
Okay, so we conducted another SWOT analysis, and this SWOT analysis is geared towards the expansion aspect and to evaluate our project at hand. So we kind of figured that the strength of this expansion would be he's going to take over an already established business. Also, another strength is a low startup cost, and the already established business comes with already contacts, resources, so that's a strength that we allocated for him. And a weakness for the expansion would be finding additional manpower. He already has a set amount of people, workers in his storefront in New Bedford, so a weakness would be finding people to travel to the storefront in Point Judith or to have a station employee there. And another weakness would be like getting the previous owner to adjust to the new way that he decides to run the business at Point Judith. An opportunity would be obviously an additional revenue stream. He would have the opportunity to probably contract with Gutterson, which is very close to the location of Point Judith. They do work with outside, like people to work with the electronics they have there, that marina. And a threat would just be a rent increase. We don't know how that would be affected when he takes over the storefront in Port Judith. It could be a rent increase, could not be a rent increase. Depends on the what they decide on once that process happens. And also a threat could be the inability to find qualified employees and like training costs.
Some of the research we also did, just finding new new revenues that you could come upon, was the deep water that we just talked about from the wind turbines, because they're going to need boats to get out there and things like that, so boats end up needing to be worked on constantly. And then also we found an article about a $150,000 grant for jobs in Rhode Island, mostly towards the fishing industry, because they're really looking to revamp the fishing industry in Rhode Island right now and in Point Judith. So there's going to be a lot more fishing boats out there, and if he expands to Point Judith, it's a perfect opportunity to get on more boats.
One of the things this grant also talked about was how they kind of want to give Point Judith a preface. They want to vamp it up, kind of make it back to how it used to be, because it kind of seemed like it was a little ragged. Now it's kind of worn down, but they really want to bring a new life to that marina and that whole area there.
Okay, so another aspect of our project was just getting experts to see what they think about the project at hand and just see if they feel like it's feasible. Again, we are students, we don't have that much experience, so we thought it'd be a good idea to find people who we know to see like what they think using the experience and knowledge that they have. And one person that we asked was Anthony Baird, and he's the director of the corporate program development here. And he just basically said that he thinks it's a good idea, he thinks expansion is always a good idea, as long as you know if the risk is worth taking and you know the financial aspect of the situation. Again, we only conducted a non-financial analysis. We didn't have enough time to conduct a financial analysis, but based off our non-financial analysis, we've also determined, along with Anthony Baird, that this may be feasible.
Also, we were able to contact two faculty members from here. One of them is Michael Bailey, who he's also a business consultant, and he was kind enough to provide us with some sort of like guidelines that they should look at before he makes up the decision. One of the things that he also did for us, he provided a boatyard business plan draft, which we will provide today. So he will be able to analyze whether the area where Dave wants to expand, which is Point Ulith, is feasible or not. And the other one was, he was willing enough to provide us a contact of a business expert on the marine electronics industry. And his name is Paul Heide, and he provided us with his contact information, which we provided as well to Dave. And then Dave could use that contact just in on a further analysis whether or not it's feasible. And the other thing that Michael said to us was that Dave should analyze whether the on his personal level, whether his mission statement matches with the expansion of into Point Ulith, because he believes, you know, an expansion takes a lot of time, a lot of energy, and also you really have to put a lot of your goals, personal goals, behind sometimes in order to expand your business. So that's something that Michael really encouraged Dave to analyze. And then the other one was David Bell, who's also a faculty member here, and he also provided some guidelines that we listed as well for Dave. One of the big ones, again, we did a non-financial analysis, but as part of the financial analysis, you should really look into consideration the cost of the expansion. That's something huge that both David and Michael mentioned to us, whether this is really like it will be feasible, but then again, like the cost of the expansion can make it non-feasible. So that's something that you really should look into consideration. And the other thing that you should look into consideration, whether the transferability of the reputation. Again, the business into Point Ulith already has a reputation, but you really should look whether the clients that already go there are gonna be able to keep them. You already have the person, which it will be the previous owner. He will provide you with all this experience. But then again, you really should analyze whether you're gonna be able to keep all of the previous reputation into the expansion.
All right, so kind of as our next steps and suggestions to Dave are, one of his big things was the Gooderson Shipyard. It's a very large shipyard that's relatively close to Point Ulith. It's not in the actual same vicinity, but it's right down the street in Quonset, so it's maybe a 10-minute ride. We did not go to look at the actual shipyard because after doing some research on it, we learned that they do a lot of work for the government ships, the Coast Guards, electric boat ships. So we felt as though if we were to go there, we wouldn't be able to walk around inside the actual shipyard due to security clearances. However, we did find that they do electronics and they do hire subcontractors to do some of their work. Since it's a really big shipyard, they do pull boats out of the water, dry dock them, and go through and strip the whole boat down and basically redo the whole thing. So when the government, in my opinion, is going to strip down a boat, or same thing with Electric Boat, who makes nuclear submarines, they're going to want to put all new equipment in. They're not going to want to really put old electronics in. They're going to want to be up to date. So for Dave, that's a great advantage for him, being able to sell all new products and also install it and then be the new contact for warranty work for them. So our suggestion for that was for Dave to actually reach out to Gooderson to see if they are accepting new subcontractors for electronics, and if it's something that his company would be able to, you know, follow up with and become a subcontractor for, because that right there would provide year-round work, especially in the wintertime when on the docks it might slow down. Another suggestion that we had, like we said, we weren't able to get into the financial aspect of it, and that's going to be another big factor for Dave, is really he's going to have to sit down and kind of talk to Barry, who is the owner of the electronic company he's looking to take over, and go over his current financials and, you know, all the information regarding the transfer of the company, how much really Barry is looking for the company and what he's expecting out of it. Another suggestion we had is to make sure it's clearly stated what each person is kind of expecting out of the transfer, because obviously Dave has his way of, you know, running his company, where since Barry was just the sole, you know, worker, owner, if he didn't want to come in one day, chances are he probably wouldn't have to, whereas now he's going to be working for Dave, that might not be an option in his eyes. It's one of those where if work needs to be done, you're on the schedule to be in, you're going to have to go in. It's not, I don't feel like going to work today, so I'm just not going to show up because it's my company. Another suggestion we had is to maybe look for an internship through the college to try and figure out a better way of getting the inventory marked down for what's going out and what's coming in. That was one of the biggest issues that Dave did say about his new location. So if you, his current location, I should say. So if he was able to get that under control and really be able to figure out what's going out so we can properly charge for the product that's leaving his warehouse, then he'll be able to easily transfer that over to the new location, so he won't have to worry about what's leaving and what's coming in. It's all going to be tracked correctly. And then our last suggestion is to either go over with a financial planner all the raw data and everything for it, or even if you continue next semester with Professor Einstein and have another group maybe dig in more to the financials, where it'll be kind of your slow season, so you'll be able to work hand in hand with them, being able to provide them with your financials, and also you can contact Barry easier and really just compare the financials and get down to what you really want to see. And then this is our work cited. Any questions? Mm-hmm.